I'm letting it play till it gets to the chorus, guys. Just one time. Here it comes. Bum, 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 bum. You ever seen those guys? Europe? Woo! They took full advantage of the 80s. 100%. 100%. Nice hair, you know? Really good stuff. Okay, everybody, Wyatt is going to be joining us today because when I put him down, he is very unhappy. So, you know, that's what happens when you have three teeth coming in at the same time. It's tough. Okay, so hi, Nicole. Hi, Caroline. Hi, Anna. Hey, Ashton. Hey, Amanda. Hey, Riley. Hey, Allison. Hi, Lindsay. Hi, Allie. Hi, Shia. Audrey is here. Oh my gosh, I haven't seen you forever. I hope I get to see you today, but if not, knowing you're here is nice. Hello, Harper. Hello, Kaylee. Hello, Tori. Hello, Autumn. Autumn, your door looks great. Did Coach Johnson do that? Wilson do that? I forget. What's your last name now?
It's Wilson, but some of the girls on my team did it. So
super nice. Super nice.
It's really good.
Hello, Olivia. Hello, Grace. Hello, Melanie. Hello, Hannah. Hello, Will. Hello, Emma. Wonderful. So I'm so happy to see all of you here today. This is going to be quite the Zoom. We're talking about Congress and we're talking about the executive branch. So, I mean, it's a fair amount to cover. I took about 6 pages of notes to prepare, you know, just to write some things down. Don't worry, you don't need to do that too. And don't forget, the beauty of these Zooms is you have the ability to go back and rewatch them later if you miss some of the information. So, I mean, that's just, you know, that's just phenomenal. So I've got several resources that I'm gonna be referring to throughout this. And by all means, I would love for you guys to ask questions and participate as well. Coach Rustay and I had to come to an agreement. I think I'm allowed to keep my Zoom at 2 today and Thursday, and I think tomorrow I have to push it back a little bit. Aren't you guys going and picking up gowns, caps and gowns tomorrow? Okay, well then that works out fine for me. Would it be okay with you if we Zoomed at 3 tomorrow? Some of you are saying yes? Okay. Well, then let's just go ahead and plan for 3, okay? Are some of you planning on going to the economics Zoom tomorrow? Or maybe he won't even have one. I don't know. I think he is having one. I think he's having
two. I am.
You're going to go? Okay. Good. I mean, you know, it's econ. I would need to go. I don't think there are enough Zooms to help me enough if it's, you know, economics. So I totally get it. I would go if I could. All right. So I'll push that to 3. And then Friday, you know, we'll only Zoom if you guys need it. Okay. So we'll address that when we get to it. Okay. And Claire popped on. Hi, Claire. All right. Why don't we start off by reviewing Congress? So if you were asked to describe Congress just using one word, I'm guessing we would use a bunch of different words, but what would the one word you use be?
Deliberate.
What would it be, Autumn?
Deliberate. Like,
yeah. Ooh, I like that. Deliberate. Yes, very slow and painstaking in their processes. That's good.
Representative.
Use a word. A different word. That's not a word. Okay. How about, hey, Shale.
Hey, Mrs. Etter.
Aw. How about bicameral? Would anybody use the word bicameral to describe Congress? You should. It's a good one. Let's talk about why bicameralism is so important. Why did the framers choose to create a bicameral legislature?
To balance the... I know one of the reasons was so that they could have, like, equal representation of the states in one branch, like, in one... like in the Senate, and then in the House, it was based off population.
Yeah, Harper, that's good to remind us of the history of the legislative branch, you know, being created, what the demands were for those who supported the Virginia plan, the large state plan, and what the demands were for those who supported the New Jersey plan, the small state plan. So yes, it did allow for different constituencies, right? Different ways to be represented. I mean, really, if we sat down, we could come up with a ton of differences between the two. Why do some people call the Senate the upper house?
Because it takes more to be a member of the Senate, and they have longer term limits, and they generally they can kind of do more important, quote unquote, things.
Yes, very good, Riley. So these folks... So not only do we have a bicameral Congress for different constituencies based on the idea that those in the House are representing the common folk, right? It's based after the House of Commons in Great Britain. And those in the Senate are representing the House of Lords or the upper class. In fact, remember back when the Constitution was written, which part of Congress could regular people vote for?
The House.
Very good, very good. Only the House, not the Senate, right? It wasn't until what amendment that people could elect senators?
17.
Yeah, I know. They all kind of run together at this point, don't they? Yeah, it's 17th. It's the 17th Amendment. I would say just think S17, S Senator, but you could say the same thing for 16. So don't do that. In the beginning, we couldn't even elect the upper house, the folks that were representing the wealthier individuals. And like Riley said, the qualifications are more stringent to be a senator. How old must you be to be a representative?
It's 25.
Very good, it's 25. Is it the same for a senator?
It's 30.
It is 30. What are the other qualifications where we find a difference between the two?
Senate has a 6-year term.
Thank you, Shale. So yet another example of the senators being seen as the upper house. They're able to do their jobs for longer. They're entrusted to do so. Yes, Autumn, length that you've been a citizen, right, of the United States. Very good. That was a good suggestion there, Autumn. S17, SE, and senator. So the amount of time you've been a citizen, 7 years for the House, 9 years for the Senate. Your age, 25 and 30. But the other qualification, you must live in the state where you're chosen. That's the same for both, which is interesting because that could lead to all 16 of Georgia's representatives being from Atlanta. It could, but it doesn't get away with that anymore. So not only are the rules different for our two body, our bicameral legislature, the qualifications are different, the membership is different, which body has more members?
The House.
Yeah, the House. Is it a significant amount more?
Yeah.
I would call 335 a little bit more, you know, a little bit bigger. You're right. Oh, happy Star Wars Day to some of you.
Oh, thanks.
You're welcome. I'm going to try putting him down, guys. Wish me luck.
Play with the puppy. You're okay.
Let me move the dog food. Struggle is real. Okay. And we also have different modes of election. So Shale already told us about how we have different term lengths. So senators, their terms are 6 years. How long are our representatives' terms for?
Two years.
Very good. So every time there is an election, your representatives are up for election. So that means that they are going to be closer or more removed to their constituents.
Closer.
Absolutely. They want you to know who they are, right? That's why, in part, they're more able to take advantage of the incumbency advantage than senators are, right? What is the incumbency advantage?
You're to get elected if you've already held that position.
Very good. You're more likely to get elected if you've held the position. That's absolutely right. Why is it that representatives are able to take advantage of that more so than our senators?
Because their term limits are shorter, so they really have less time to kind of learn how the House works, and more people think that if it's easier to let them kind of do it and keep it smoothly running instead of having people learn how the processes work every 2 years.
Sure. They would, absolutely. I mean, they're up for election every 2 years. People know them more. They have a higher recognition because they're campaigning like crazy. So that is certainly part of what contributes to the incumbency advantage. Think about gerrymandering. Okay, when we gerrymander, first off, what is gerrymandering besides our favorite vocabulary word ever?
When you draw district lines irregularly, nice way to put it, to get to get a district to be like Democrat or Republican.
That's right, Tori. And it really depends on which party is in power. So if they're drawing district lines to benefit their party, does that benefit representatives or senators more?
Representatives.
That's right, because that's their district, right? What are the district lines for senators, everybody? Yeah, Autumn's got it. The state. The state itself is the district line. Lucy McBath represents y'all. Barry Loudermilk represents me. Kelly Loeffler and David Perdue represent us. You see what I'm saying? So only a third of the Senate is ever up for re-election at the same time. People call it a continuous open body. Ooh, hang on. Hi, honey. Is there any way you could try to pick him up? He will not go down.
Why?
Correct. He isn't here with me as I'm zooming.
Yeah.
Don't take off your shirt. I'm zooming with my student son. Sorry. Yeah, give it a shot. Say hi.
Hey guys.
Okay.
Come here,
boy. Okay. Alrighty, let's see here. Let's talk about powers, okay? So implied powers and express powers of Congress, because I am positive. Well, I guess I'm not positive. If this were the traditional AP exam, I would be positive that we would see questions on these. But this would be great because you could mention all three branches here. You could mention Supreme Court cases where they've affirmed that a check that one branch has used is, you know, constitutional or not. Or, of course, judicial review is a great example of a check and balance itself. So what are some express powers of Congress?
They can borrow money, collect taxes. They have the power of the purse, so they can set the federal budget. Commerce, interstate commerce. And they can I think that they can declare war, right?
Yes, yes, very good. I'm so glad we brought that up because it's really important we understand the war power and war making powers. Good, you gave us a lot there, Harper. Yeah, so coining money, creating and collecting taxes, regulating interstate and foreign commerce, which is the Commerce Clause itself, declaring war, raising and supporting a military, and then of course creating lower courts. All of these are express powers of Congress. Nice, 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 nice. Now, is that all that they have? Do they only have express powers, powers that are in the Constitution word for word? No. What other powers do they have, pumpkin pies?
Very improper.
Implied and necessary and proper.
Good, good. I love how so many of you are saying necessary and proper or implied because samesies. Really, samesies for Congress. All of their implied powers come from the Necessary and Proper Clause, also known as the Elastic Clause. So express powers, there's really no misconstruing these because it says it in there that they can do it. I mean, it's right there. It's very clear. But implied powers, it gets a little sticky. It gets a little sticky. And of course, that's where a wise grasshopper would mention what Supreme Court case involving the National Bank?
McCullough.
Very good. Very good, girls. McCullough v. Maryland. Okay. So anything that Congress can do to help them carry out their expressed powers is an implied power. That's what the Necessary and Proper Clause says. Congress has the power to do whatever is necessary and proper for carrying into execution their foregoing express powers. So there you go. That's pretty much that one. But there are some differences, yet again, for our bicameral legislature. Things that the House can do, express powers, and then things that the Senate can do, specifically themselves, that are expressed. What's one thing that the House can do specifically?
Impeach tax laws.
Great. Both of those work. Lovely. Yeah, so the House can impeach a federally elected official from the executive branch or from the judicial branch. Absolutely, the House can impeach. And remember, all impeach is a simple word. It's just a charge with a crime, okay? And since it's just charging with a crime, what vote is needed?
Simple majority.
Booyah, just simple majority, okay? When we take it to the next level in the Senate, what can the Senate do that is specific to them?
Remove.
Yes. They can remove, they can try, you know, you have to try them first, right? No bills of attainder here. But yes, they can try and they can remove that official. Very good. But that's a bigger deal. So do they need more votes? Yes, I see heads nodding out there. Yes, and Autumn wrote 2/3. That is correct. What do we call that, 2/3 vote?
Supermajority.
Correct. I do want to make sure we're using that language. Okay. Excellent. 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 Okay. What are some other, and then we mentioned taxation bills. Yes. Bills for taxation must originate in the House of Representatives. Does anybody happen to recall which specific committee?
Ways and Means.
Very good. It is the Ways and Means Committee. Excellent. So all bills for taxation have to originate in the Ways and Means Committee in the House of Representatives. Why? Why does that have to be with the House and not the Senate?
Because the Senate used to not be directly elected, so we're afraid of taxation without representation, so the House gets that job.
Good, good. Guys, I've said it 1,000 times in class, the House of Representatives is the truest representation of the American public, of our representative democracy. It's who we could elect in the beginning. They're closer to us based on their constituency size and how often they're elected. And that's who we could vote for. So it makes sense that that's where bills for taxation would originate, as opposed in the upper house. In the House of Lords, I mean, heck, we fought a revolution to get away from the Lords, did we not? So we don't want to give the Senate that power. Very good. What is something else that is unique to the Senate?
Confirming appointments.
Okay, very good. I heard confirmation and approving of appointments, which is essentially, you know, samesies. So yes, and Autumn, you're mentioning the judiciary hearings that will take place when you have a federal judge who has been nominated by who?
The president.
Correct, nominated by the president, but then that person must be confirmed by the Senate. The Senate has this power, there's less of them. They have the Judiciary Committee that is pretty much devoted to doing this, that standing committee. But all that's needed to fill these vacancies or to confirm, that's the word I want you to use, these appointments is a simple majority. If it had to be 2/3, we would have vacancies that remained vacant forever. Forever. You think the Supreme Court had a vacancy for a long time? No, it would be nuts. So just a simple majority, right? And the same is true for what other appointed officials by the president that must be confirmed by the Senate?
The cabinet.
Okay, cabinet, good. That's not where I was going, but that totally works. Think of foreign policy.
Ambassadors.
Yes. Good. Alrighty. And then something else that the Senate can do, it's just for the Senate. We said confirmation. We said removing from office. This one has to do with ratifying something.
Treaties.
Yes. Now, I want you to think about it. What vote should be necessary for ratifying a treaty?
A supermajority.
Correct. And Autumn, yeah, you hit the nail on the head. So Tori, it is a supermajority. Autumn, it's 2/3. In fact, guys, all of the supermajorities that are listed in the Constitution are 2/3, with the exception of two. Do we happen to recall what those two are?
Cloture and ratifying an amendment.
Good job, Tori. That's right. Good job. So cloture sounds a lot like closure, right? And yes, 3/4 is one of them, Autumn. Cloture is where the senators can vote to end a
filibuster.
Yay, filibuster, Nicole. Good job, Autumn. And guys, filibusters, I mean, they're just so much fun. Miss Minute came over here on, what night was that? Saturday, and she, bless her heart, asked me about filibusters, and an hour later. So yeah, filibusters can only be used in what part of Congress?
Senate.
Yeah, only in the Senate, because there's 100 of them. And the filibuster is this tactic that these senators want to use for what? What is the purpose of a filibuster besides to make the rest of America go?
To talk a bill to death.
That's right, to kill a bill, talk a bill to death. Let your peers know how passionately you are against something that's being voted on, and give them time to maybe make a change to it that you would be okay with and then would vote on. It's a tactic. Rarely are they actually successful. But you know, whatever. Okay, good. So that's yet another example of why the House and the Senate are two separate bodies in our legislative branch, and how they can do different things. They have different rules. Who's the leader of the House?
The Speaker.
It is the Speaker of the House. Who's the leader of the Senate?
The Vice President.
Good, but can Mike Pence be there all the time?
No,
he really can't. He's busy, especially right now, yeah. So if he's not there, you've got the president pro tempore that's filling in, but that's largely a ceremonial role. So in the House, it's really Nancy Pelosi, you're right, Autumn, that has most of the power. And in the Senate, what's the senator that you hear about all the time? Who is it?
Mitch McConnell.
Yeah, it's Mitch McConnell, and he's the majority leader. So that's who we hear about most of the time. He's the majority leader. Why?
Because he's the most senior member of the Republican Party that controls the Senate.
Yeah, he's a pretty dang senior member. You're right, Tori. And the Republican Party does control the Senate, hence majority party. Good. What are the majority party leader's assistants called that make sure party members are voting with the party?
Whips.
Yeah, those are your whips, right? Ensuring that policy does not go too far out of a comfort zone for the political party that's trying to pass it. Nicely done. Okay, so the House is closer to the people, like we said. They have a smaller constituency. The incumbency advantage is the greatest there. A phrase that you might see a week from today on your exam is how the Senate is considered to be more politically insulated. Would anybody be willing to speak to that? And don't forget, you can use that as well if you don't want to speak aloud.
Isn't it just because they get elected less frequently, so they have more time to, they don't really have to be as reliant on their voters to kind of like, so they can do what they know is best for the voters versus what they think they want.
Very good, Riley. Since they're not always going to be reelected every time, or they're not up for reelection every time, excuse me, they're a continuous open body. That does mean they're able to fulfill that role of, anybody know?
Trustee.
Yes, they're able to act as a trustee, which is exactly what, thank you, Tori, which is exactly what Riley was just describing. They can vote on things more their conscience, how they feel things should be done, and not necessarily bow to the will of the people. And so if they do something that's not going to be very popular with the people of their home state, they're not up for re-election right now. A great example, if you ever want to decide it, would be when Mitt Romney voted to actually remove President Trump this past go-round. Chances are the folks in Utah, not super down with that. Chances are his party, not really happy about that whatsoever. But he's not up for re-election this year, so he's a little bit more politically insulated. Usually when you hear the phrase politically insulated, what branch am I referring to usually?
The Supreme Court.
The Supreme Court, Audrey, that's right, and the judicial branch, yes, Tori, because those lifetime positions mean that they don't have to worry about getting elected, and they can just do what they want to do. Maybe not what they want to do, but they don't have to worry about what's popular. Okay? Has anybody seen Wicked? Popular is the song they sing in it. It's so good. Okay, other things that I wrote down that I just want to make sure we're good on, show me thumbs, and folks who are not, who don't have your cameras on, you'll need to write the word up or down in the chat. How are we on pork barreling and earmarks? Oh, okay. Okay, Shale put a thumbs up. Nice, thank you. Way to use that technology. Okay, and we're not 100%. This is where most of you were. Okay, so let's talk about it. Pork barrel spending. This is legislation, so it's actually laws that are passed pork barrel, to do what? Think of a district that has a lot of pigs. Think of a district that makes a lot of barrels.
Bring money to a district, like specifically for what the constituents want.
Yes, Audrey, very good. So if you are in office and you manage to get a little spending project in a bill that will benefit your home state, remember like the Rodeo Museum of South Dakota? That's an example of pork barrel spending, is the legislature where the money you spend is going to benefit your area. The actual dollars and amount, that's an earmark. Just think like a mark on an ear. It's a specific amount of money that is being allocated for a specific thing. So pork barrels will always involve earmarks. Earmarks don't always have to involve pork barreling, okay? The stimulus package that Congress has passed, you know, in all the phases to deal with COVID-19, it has tons of earmarks in it, things for small business. That's not pork, right? That doesn't help one district in particular. That helps a ton. Okay, does that help? Okay. Log rolling. How are we? Thank you, Emma. How are we on log rolling? Anybody want to tell me what the heck it is? I see one thumb up. I see a thumb here. Here, here. Anybody want to take a guess? What's log rolling?
Like that one, they just like, oh, go. Sorry. No, go.
It was like so delayed.
Okay, thank you, Tori. Go ahead, Harper.
Log rolling is basically like vote trading in Congress, so someone can say like, I'll vote for your policy if you vote for mine.
Good, good. It kind of makes me think of those old lumberjack competitions that would be on TV every now and then, you know, if ESPN doesn't have anything else to show and they show, you know, these jacked up people cutting down trees or rolling a log, I don't know. But yeah, so it's senators and representatives agreeing to support each other's projects, right? Or earmarks. Lauren, do you have a question, honey? Okay, you highlight.
Oh, sorry.
That's okay. I'm so glad you're here. And so the idea is that if so many people sign on to support the bill, the log starts rolling down the hill and you cannot stop it because it's a log. It's heavy. And it's going to roll right past any other blockage because it's got so many people supporting it. But then you better remember, if you support a senator's earmark on something, that they'll be asked to support yours on the next one. So that's why pork barreling, even though it's not supposed to be around anymore, it's still pretty much a staple in legislative action. Oversight. How are we on oversight? Yeah? Okay. What's the best example of congressional oversight then?
With bureaucracies.
Yes, very good, Harper. Messing with their budgets, right? If the EPA does something that the Republican-controlled Congress does not like, okay. We'll just slash your funding, no problem. It's kind of a you got to use it or you lose it situation. If a, I hate Facebook, but a person I know from high school was commenting on the Thunderbirds and the Blue Angels fly over the other day, and they were making it very political and calling it wasteful spending and things like that. And so several people got very passionate and weighed in on it. And one of those individuals was a Air Force pilot. And he said, look, if we don't spend this money that's allocated to us in our budget every year, we don't get that amount again. And so these pilots and these planes, they can't just sit around. They have to do things. And so this is a morale booster. We actually are using these funds. Air shows are not taking place anymore, which usually generates some funds as well. So if we don't use this money that's been allocated to us, we can't just like donate it and give it back to the government because then we won't see it next year. So I thought that was a pretty interesting explanation. The person was not satisfied though. So anyway. Oversight is just where they kind of keep an eye, in addition to checks and balances, over how the bureaucracy is implementing the laws that they passed. So how is the EPA doing with that, with the Clean Air and Water Act? One of the recent SCOTUS decisions says that underwater or underground water is subject to the same testing as above ground water for pollution. So that's kind of interesting. Okay. What about, do we need to talk about committees? Yes, no. If you were to see a committee on there, the only one I think you might see is the conference committee. Do you guys recall what the conference committee is useful for?
It irons out the differences between the bill passed in the Senate and the House.
Yes, Audrey, that's absolutely right. In our bill into a law process, the bill must pass in the exact same version in the House and the Senate. That's not going to happen. There's just no way, unless you have groups or people from both the House and the Senate coming together to iron out those differences, like you said. Now, once the bill differences are ironed out, the House passes on it, the House passes it and the Senate passes it. Where does it go before that bill can become law, folks?
The president. Well, it goes back to like both houses and then it goes to the president.
Correct, correct. So both houses have to pass it. You're absolutely right. And then it goes to POTUS. POTUS can do four things. Somebody give me one.
Sign.
Pocket veto.
Ignore it.
What?
Or just veto it, right? Yeah. All right, so sign it, it becomes law, bada bing, bada boom, woohoo. If they ignore it after 10 days, what is the status of the bill?
It becomes law.
It's law. That's right. It's law. Very good. Now, the president can also veto it. It can go back to Congress. Can Congress override a veto?
Yes, with 2/3 in the Senate and the House.
Very good. A 2/3 majority vote is needed, and that is tough to get, especially in what time?
Divided government.
Yes, divided government, where there's one party in the
executive,
and another party in the
legislative.
Very good. Very good. That's okay, Autumn, no worries. Okay. Let's say Congress is within 10 days of ending. That's when the pocket veto can come out. And I love the pocket veto. I think it is sneaky. The president can pocket veto it. And after 10 days, what has happened to it?
It dies.
It dies. That's right, Julius. It's donezo. It is gone. It is out of here. That's the pocket veto. Why use the pocket veto? Why not just veto?
Because they might not want to be seen vetoing it.
Yeah, that's right, Audrey. One person overriding the majority will of 535 people, that can seem kind of absolute, right? That can seem kind of shady. So that's why the pocket veto is so handy. So handy.
Ms. Better.
Yes, Harper.
What's the difference between ignoring and a pocket veto?
Great question. The difference between ignoring and the pocket veto is when Congress is within 10 days of adjourning. The ignoring it, that's all the time. Pocket veto is only within those 10 days of dipping out. Okay? All right. Let's see here. So are we okay, bill into a law? I think Schoolhouse Rock did a nice job of that for us. The budget. I just don't know, guys. I don't know if they're going to ask you anything about the budget, so I figure might as well go over it just in case. Which two branches are involved in making the budget? Is it the judicial branch?
No.
That's not judicial review. I mean, can you imagine? No. It's legislative and executive. So that's a good thing to know, that it's a shared responsibility between the two. Which branch or which person, it's probably too much of a hint there, proposes the budget? Autumn says POTUS, and she's right. So president proposes, just think PP, president proposes. And then Congress has to pass it. But of course, if they don't like it, and if they can't agree, what happens?
The government shuts down.
That it does, Tori. And hopefully we will not see a 35-day shutdown again anytime soon. It's frustrating. But yeah, you could have a government shutdown. Now, the reason why passing a budget is so hard is because you're getting at the root of the political differences, right? You have Republicans who don't want to increase taxes, Democrats who do want to increase taxes and spending. It's a problem. And part of the problem is entitlement programs, because entitlement programs are part of mandatory spending. What's an entitlement program? Can anybody think of any?
Social Security,
Medicaid.
Excellent. Medicaid, Medicare, Social Security. All of those things, you're entitled to the benefits if you meet the qualifications. And Social Security, that just means if you're old enough and if you've paid in enough. My mom only worked for 7 years. By the time I came along, she decided to stay at home, which, I mean, no idea how she did it. I'm going to be honest with you guys. Being a stay-at-home parent, no. Not for me. Not for me. I'm pulling out my hair. You can't see it. It's all gone. I lost my train of thought because I got so stressed out just thinking about it.
Social Security.
Thank you. Thank you, Harper. Okay, so my mom only worked for 7 years, and so she didn't really pay enough into Social Security to qualify for it. And then she worked at Hallmark for a couple of years, and so finally she found out she made enough to get a very small Social Security check by the time she turned 65. But yeah, so if you meet the requirements, you're entitled to those benefits. And entitlement programs are mandatory spending, meaning it's required by law. It's locked in the budget. Nothing you can do about it. Do you think more of the federal budget is mandatory spending or discretionary spending?
Mandatory.
Oh, yes. I mean, you can't compare the two. It's not like apples and oranges. It's like apples and Kalmata olives. Okay, I mean, very different, very different. It's like 80-20, it's ridiculous. So discretionary spending, not only is it a smaller amount and a smaller percentage of the budget, but it also includes things that cost a lot of money, like defense spending. And so when one particular party is in power, they want a lot more defense spending. Which party is that?
Republican.
Yeah, it's the Republicans. So you can imagine the Democrat counterparts really push back against that. And so it's just this cluster and it's crazy. But yeah, so that's the budget. Usually it doesn't get passed. And so you're saying, well, then why aren't we shut down? They just pass emergency spending legislation for the entire fiscal year is what they do. I'm not kidding. If you looked at how many actual budgets that we've passed in the last, I don't know, 20 years, it's probably 5. It's interesting. Okay. Are we good on delegate, trustee, and politico? Which one does what their constituents want?
Delegate.
Yep, they're there to represent the people. Very good. So then what's a politico? We talked about a trustee earlier.
Both.
Yeah, very good. It's a combination of the two, right? Sometimes you do what your constituents would like you to do, but other times you have to hope that they trust that you'll make the right decision, because sometimes what the American public wants is not the right decision. Politicians, some, hopefully, can look a little bit further into the future and think about what would be best for the nation. And the American public at the time may not be able to see that. Maybe they're too hot about something that's going on. A couple other vocabulary terms I want to make sure we know. Bipartisan. Do we know bipartisan? Okay, all of you shaking your heads. What is it?
When both parties agree.
That's right. It's where there's a combined effort to see some legislation passed. Very good. Which, just think of the BCRA, right? The Bipartisan Campaign Reform Act. I mean, they actually put the word in the title. So there you go. Gridlock. Do we all know what gridlock is? Yeah? What is it?
When nothing can get passed because the Congress can't agree.
Very good, Audrey. And that's really heightened in times of divided government, right? Very good, very good, very good. And then one more thing that I would note, because all these other terms could fit in here as well, is the lame duck period. You guys remember studying the lame duck period? Just think of that little duck swimming in a circle. What is the lame duck period?
It's when when a president's been elected in November, but they haven't been sworn in yet, so the old president is still in office, but he can't really do anything because he's technically not really the president.
Good, Riley, that's right. So, and Lauren agrees with you, the period between presidents. If you want to actually use an example, if they ask you about this on your exam on Monday, my example, what I would suggest is saying President Obama in 2016, because he was term limited, so he was done. And he actually made another nomination to the Supreme Court, Merrick Garland, and it went nowhere, nowhere. So that is the epitome of a lame duck. The Republican senators just totally put off voting on that in the hopes that there would be a Republican president elected in 2016, and they would then be able to fill that vacancy of Antonin Scalia with another conservative. And that is what they got. They got what they wanted. So there you go. Great example of a lame duck. Can anybody tell me which amendment shortened the lame duck period?
The 20th.
Yes, it did, Tori. And here's how I remember that. It just, it states the presidential term starting dates and congressional term starting dates. And the president's term starting date is January the 20th. Yeah, hence 20th Amendment. Okay? All right. Could I also use John Adams and the midnight appointments as an example of lame duck? You know, he had the Federalists still with him autumn when he was leaving office, and he actually got a fair amount of those people taken care of. So I don't think I would go with him as the best example, but you could certainly use that as an example for transitioning of power. And how desperately people try to do things at the end of their presidency. Ooh, what's something that presidents do a lot in the lame duck period where they're at the very end of their presidency, which is not popular with the American people?
Pardons.
Yes, pardons. Oh, I mean, people hate pardons because, so what, our judicial system doesn't work? Is that what you're saying? Yes, that's what they're saying. Or it just doesn't work for their people, right? And I mean, hey, I'm not saying the judicial system is perfect. I am not saying that at all. Anyway, yeah, pardons are super unpopular. Hey, is the presidential power to pardon an expressed power or an implied power?
Expressed.
Oh, yes. Thank you. Thank you, Tori. It is in there. It says it right there in Article what? Ooh, thank you. All right, so let's talk about the president a wee bit. But before we do that, are we okay to leave the legislative branch? Bless you, Lindsay. Are we okay? You sure? It's the biggest one. I mean, if we're looking at an odd situation here, like looking at Vegas odds, I would assume that they would ask something about Congress. Okay. All right, then let's do it. By the way, I got my absentee ballot in the mail the other day. I made my friends take a picture. I'll post it on Schoology. Have any of you guys gotten your official absentee ballots? Not the registration, but the ballots. Riley, you did? Allie, you did? Tori? No.
My parents did. I helped them vote, though.
Thank you, sweetheart. I appreciate it. Who else got theirs? Let me see. Who got theirs? Hold up your hand. Amanda, Audrey. Yay! Guys, it's going to be so exciting. Okay. So let's talk about the president, seeing as though we're in a presidential election year. I mean, y'all, this is going to be studied for years. This time period that we're in, the fact that we're in a presidential election. Nuts. Nuts. And guess what? I'm guessing that because of the Wisconsin SCOTUS ruling, if you don't get your absentee ballot in when you're supposed to, you know, they receive it 7 days before the election date. As long as it's postmarked by then, it should be counted. That was part of the Wisconsin SCOTUS ruling, just FYI. It'll be a part of the DBQ for APUSH exams. You might be right, Autumn. Or else it's going to be something obscure, like Gifford Pinchot. Okay, let's talk about the POTUS. Selection, qualifications, term length. The president is in office for how many years? Four, that's right. How many terms? And since when?
The 22nd Amendment.
Thank you, Harper. That's right. Since the 22nd Amendment. It was Washington that set the precedent, but both Roosevelts attempted, one did, to at least defy the precedent, right? Okay. Qualifications, pretty straightforward. You got to be 35. You've got to be born here. You've got to live here for 14 years. It's the selection that's more interesting. What body selects the President of the United States?
Electoral College.
Thank you, Audrey. So then what is our vote called?
Popular vote.
Yes. And the structure of that was changed with what amendment, my darling dears? They went from having one vote to two votes. The 12th, right? Electoral College went from voting once to voting twice. They used to just vote for president and the runner-up would become vice president. That's not a cluster waiting to happen, right? But now they vote for the president and then they vote for the vice president, 12th Amendment. What did Federalist 70 say about the executive?
There needs to be only
one. Energy.
Energetic.
No. Only one, very good. And they've gotta be energetic, yes. In order to be efficient and get the job done. Very good, very good. Something else that I would note if I were you guys is the different roles of the president. So the president has to act as chief executive. Now, of course, part of this comes from the executive power, right? The power to actually execute law. But who helps him be the chief executive? What's his team of advisors called?
Oh, the White House staff?
Yeah, you've got your White House staff, very good, with your chief of staff, your communications officer, basically everybody on West Wing. But then, yes, you also have your cabinet, okay? And the president is the head of the cabinet. The people who are on the cabinet serve at the will of the president. And if the president doesn't like the job you're doing, deuces, you're donezo. Another role of the president is chief diplomat. Who can think of an express power that fits under chief diplomat?
Treaties,
very good. Yeah, making and dealing with heads of foreign nations. I mean, you know, who knows what's happening with Kim Jong-un, guys? I don't know. But yeah, coming to deals with them and treaties. Don't say executive agreements yet. Okay. What's another express power that's also a title for the president and has to do with the military?
Commander-in-Chief.
Commander-in-Chief.
Very good. Commander-in-Chief. Everybody knew that one. Now, can the president declare war as Commander-in-Chief? No. Who declares war? Congress. Very good. So then what the heck can the president do as Commander-in-Chief, folks? Autumn says station troops, that's right. Okay, so he can send troops into combat. What else can he do? Or she, just not yet.
Launch missiles.
That's right, Tori, launch missiles. Don't forget about the nuclear football that they have access to. And call airstrikes, that's right, Autumn. Now, is the president limited in how long he can use troops for? Yes. Anybody thinking of a very famous piece of legislation?
The War Powers Act.
Yes, the War Powers Act. Now, I'm obviously getting excited about the War Powers Act for a few reasons. Can anybody tell me one reason why I'm getting excited about it?
The War Powers
Act. Audrey, you're slowing up a little bit on me. Say it again.
The War Powers Act.
Yeah. The War Powers Act, it's exciting. I love it. Why is it so interesting?
It limited the power, it took back some power from the president.
It did take back some power from the president. That's right. It's power that Congress had given up
And
oh, I didn't say anything, but the war powers doesn't do anything.
Say it again, sweetie. It's a terrible delay on my end. I'm sorry, it's my fault. I'm sure it's just a fabulous computer. So Congress had surrendered that power, right? During the Vietnam War, the Gulf of Tonkin Resolution, and the president didn't want to give it back. But Congress made this act, and then the president vetoed it. Who vetoed it? It's the man everybody loves to hate.
Nixon.
Yeah. Good job, Shia. I saw it. I see it on him. Nixon vetoes it. Congress overrides it. What? So exciting. And so it's law. It's law. And so if the president uses troops, they've got to let Congress know within how many hours of deploying them?
48.
Very good, 48. And those troops can stay where they are for how many days unless Congress extends it?
60.
60, that's right. Very good. And they'll say 60 to 90 if there's problems with getting them out on time. Very good. So that's the War Powers Act. So that gives you another idea of what power could fit under that express power of commander-in-chief for the president. As legislative leader, the president has some express powers too. Can anybody think of an express power the president has in terms of legislation? Okay. Yeah, I heard lots of things. I heard State of the Union address, and I heard veto and pocket veto. And make sure, I can't imagine this would be the thing that shows up there. If they ask you about the line item veto, that's not presidents, it's only governors, okay? So if you see that, go, nope, not POTUS, just governor. Okay. So then what are informal powers of the president?
Executive orders.
Nice, Harper, executive orders. What about for treaties? What do we call them? Executive?
Agreements.
Agreements, very good. And then you also have signing statements and you have executive privilege. Those four things are all examples of what? Does anybody know?
Unilateral executive action.
Very good. Unilateral presidential or executive action. Unilateral meaning what?
One way.
Just him. Just him. Doesn't really have to check with anybody else about doing this. I mean, that's part of why Hamilton said we needed one person there in Federalist 70. Yeah, so executive privilege, I do want to make sure you guys remember that that has been limited by SCOTUS, okay? The best example one could give of that is Nixon versus the U.S. when he tried to hide his, creepy tapes, right? What a dum-dum. Excuse me. Executive agreements and executive orders. These are similar. Why are they similar?
They don't require review.
Very good. They don't require review from Congress, okay? But they have the same force of what they would be if Congress had reviewed them. So executive orders have the same force of what?
Treaty.
Executive orders.
Oh, sorry. Laws.
Yes, I know. It's Star Wars Day. It's okay. Your head can be in space. Yes, so executive orders have the same force of law, but they bypass Congress. So guys, does that mean they're permanent? Good, they're not. Good. Executive orders have the same force of treaties, but yet again, they bypass Congress. So yet again, not permanent. So guys, if they're not permanent, then why does any president use them?
They're fast.
No.
That's right.
It's just to save time.
I mean, really, guys, let's be honest. That's fair. They are quick. They get the job done. And I mean, Congress is slow and deliberate on purpose. But executive action, that can happen very quickly.
signing statements. This is what the president writes on a law that they're signing, or a bill that they're signing into a law. If they're not crazy about something, they might say, I'm going to sign this, but I may not do what you want me to do. Just saying. That's a signing statement. Some vocab that I think you might get confused on is the bully pulpit and going public. You guys remember those two? If you stop and just think about it, I think the difference makes sense. What is an example of Trump using the bully pulpit?
Tweeting at people.
Yes, nice. And I actually know what that means. Yeah, so tweeting at people, right? You're appealing to the public, Twitter is public, to pressure those other branches into complying with what you want, right? You're saying, listen, go after them. Hey, and you know, the use of nicknames is always popular with our president as well, right? So pressure these individuals to get them to do what I want them to do. Join me, help me. So then what's going public?
It's just when they like ask the public to like support legislation. It like most comments like State of the Union where they're like, we should pass this. And Congress is like, fine, what you said.
Yes, exactly. Going public, just think they're talking to the public, trying to get the public to support them. Bully pulpit, you're actually trying to beat up those other people into complying with what you want. Checks and balances, maybe? How does the legislative branch check the executive branch?
Money.
Yes, the power of the purse. Good. They don't have to use money to enforce an executive order. Nice. What's another check for the legislative branch on the executive branch?
Overrides.
Very good. Congressional overrides. Excellent. What's one more?
Confirming a point.
Oversight.
Oversight, which can include confirming or denying appointments. Very good. And what was a very famous example of a check this year?
Impeachment.
Excellent. Impeachment and removal. Very good. So those are all legislative checks on the executive. What are some executive checks on the legislative branch?
Veto.
Any more?
Isn't it like the power of the sword or something like that?
Yeah, sure, Riley. Absolutely. Actually enforcing laws. Congress makes them, but he's got to enforce them. Excellent. Any more?
I mean, could you say signing statement?
I think you could, Tori. Absolutely think you could say unilateral executive action. Yeah. Totally. Okay. I know that was a lot today. I'm sure your hands are probably cramped and they're like, what is happening? What, I haven't done this for so long. Tomorrow we focus on the judicial branch and we very quickly review civil rights and liberties. And for my students this semester, you're probably like, why are we even reviewing that? Because my first semester kids, I haven't reviewed it with them. So we are going to do that. And heck, it doesn't hurt just to tune in and get that information, right? Is there anything that came up today that you guys want to ask about?
How much do you think we're going to have to know about the bureaucracy for, because of the, we didn't really go over the specifics of it during the Zoom.
I know.
So do you think?
Miss Sutter.
Yes, honey.
There was this one, I mean, obviously, no one can predict it, but there was this one guy who, like, I was watching on YouTube, and he was, like, giving examples of what they might do, and he said that the AP exam, like, loves to talk about congressional oversight, and he said he could see them asking something about congressional oversight and bureaucracies.
Okay. So that's kind of what. Okay, that's good. I think you could talk about how the bureaucracy exists to help the president do their job. and how even though the framers designed the Constitution for the legislative branch to be the largest branch of government, the executive branch has become the largest branch in part because of the bureaucracy. And you could certainly talk about cabinet, but I imagine maybe independent agencies would be where they would go with that. Independent executive agencies like NASA, the Environmental Protection Agency, and I mean, there's hundreds more, government corporations like the USPS, the Postal Service. But maybe, really, I think the key thing with the bureaucracy is just their size and how slow they are with regulations and how much they need money to get their job done. And if Congress is unhappy with the way a bureaucratic department is handling their legislation or actually coming up with enforcements, then that's when they can mess with their budgets. So I imagine, Nicole and Harper, that would probably be the only thing that you would see. That's just...
Also, I don't know, obviously, but he was also saying that, like, the president and, like, the executive branch puts power in the bureaucracies and, like, gives them the power to make laws and stuff because, like, with the environment, the president and the executive branch, like, they don't specialize in that, so that's why they make bureaucracies. Mm-hmm. But then if they step over their power of, like, making those laws, like, that's when the congressional oversight comes in. So that's why I was, like, making that connection.
But. Sure. Okay, so what you're talking about is bureaucratic legislation. Yeah. That's regulations. That's regulations. So that's them coming up with measurable requirements that can, if they're not followed through with, can involve penalties, financial penalties, and some other things like that. Remember, like, bureaucratic education, where they can actually... sorry, Dr. Ritchie just sent us the subject line is nothing but cakes, so I got distracted. Where they can actually issue fines and determine if people did not follow the regulations the way that they should. And if you need to give an example of something like that, you can just bring up emissions for your car. Yeah. But I'll look through and see if there's anything in the bureaucracy that I should have mentioned, but I don't know, usually just understand.
I think the biggest is just discretion, regulation, and adjudication.
Yeah, yeah. So how the law is going to be implemented, discretion, regulation, actually putting that into, things that can be followed by the public and by companies, and then adjudication, determining if their rules or regulations were broken. Thank you, Tori. Yeah. Yeah. And I mean, you could also bring up the Iron Triangle. They're an example of the Iron Triangle. So that's not a bad thing to bring up, Harper, where you have the congressional committee, the administrative agency, and the interest group. And they're all working together in their specific policy area. We could see that too. Yeah. Anything else, pumpkins? And we'll do this at the end of Thursday's Zoom as well. And I even thought Monday before your exam, we could hop on and have one if anybody had any questions.
Tomorrow at 3, right?
Tomorrow at 3. All right, well then let's take it out, y'all. I think we're done. Thank you for coming in today. I think I said hi to everybody. Mackenzie, I don't think I said hi to you. Melody and Erin, hi to you. And Anna, I don't think I said hi to you. Hannah and Grace and Melanie. But everybody, take care. I'll leave you with some Edgar Winter Group today. Thanks for coming by. This is called Frankenstein.